brownpapertickets.com and at supporting independent bookstores. For this wry evening with a great economist, cutting through the bullfruit, offering a positive outlook, February 10th.
And you are listening to 94.1 KPFA and 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, and 97.5 K248BR in Santa Cruz, and online at kpfa.org. The time is 2:30. Stay tuned next for Pushing Limits.
Keep on pushing. Keep on pushing. I've got to keep on pushing. I can't stop now.
Hi, this is Eddie Ituarte here at KPFA in Berkeley. And today we're doing the Pushing Limits show, the radio program about disability for and about the disability community. And Paul Longmore was a prominent author, historian, activist who died unexpectedly in 2010. He taught at San Francisco State University, where he became director of the Institute on Disability, and later and that name was later changed to Paul Longmore Institute in remembrance of him after he passed away in 2010. Today, we're pleased here at Pushing Limits to have as our guest Catherine Kalik, who is now the executive director of the Paul Longmore Institute, and we'll talk about the institute and the role and importance of disability studies in the university system. So welcome, Catherine.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here.
Catherine, I admit I lost the short bio that you sent me. Could you just give us a little bit of background of yourself, please?
Sure. Yeah, I teach history at San Francisco State University, and I direct the Paul Longmore Institute on disability. And I identify as somebody with a vision impairment. I sometimes joke that I'm imperfectly blind, which means I see more than I should and don't see what I should see either. I am a historian who's worked on disability history and disability issues, history of medicine, primarily in France and the United States. And my perch recently has made me try to carry forward the messages of Paul Longmore and take it to new levels.
Mm-hmm. And can you tell us a little bit about Paul Longmore?
So Paul was amazing. He was a force of nature. He was 64 years old when he died. He had polio. He contracted polio when he was 7 years old. And he lived with the consequences of that, both physical and social, and quickly came to realize that a lot of the challenges he's faced were not so much physical challenges, but were social and prejudice and all of that. And he started to connect the civil rights ideas for other minority groups with disability, and started to promote a lot of these ideas around disability. And his historical research was on actually George Washington initially, but he was also a disability activist. And he discovered that when he was writing his historical research and had just published it, that he was not going to be able to earn book royalties for his book on George Washington and at the same time keep his Social Security benefits, because that was considered income that he was not going to be entitled to. So he established this theatrical sort of presence. He went to pulled out a barbecue pit, a Weber cooker, one of those things, in front of the Social Security Administration in Los Angeles. This was in 1988. He set fire to his book about George Washington. It was a biography, and said, "I cannot keep this book because I can't earn royalties on it." And it made quite an impression. It was a very outrageous act, as somebody is real spirited and real open. And it ended up, they reframed some of the Social Security Administration policy, and it ultimately became named the Longmore Amendment, and they allowed people to earn royalties. There's still problems with that law. But anyway, he really set this this example of being an activist and an academic, and everybody knew him. He was very charismatic, very mm-hmm. funny, very charming, and very smart.
So, well, a couple of things. Yes, very smart. The way you described him, thank you for that. He's also had a bit of an attitude, which we certainly need, that trip, aggressive attitude.
Absolutely.
At times. And also he was creative. I mean, that's mm-hmm. a nice creative
yes.
thing. So what about the Institute now? You've been there since what, several years?
Yeah, I started, they did a national recruitment. When Paul died unexpectedly in 2010, San Francisco State decided to honor his memory by naming an institute that he actually founded, the Institute on Disability. They decided to honor his memory by naming it for him and then doing a national recruitment to hire a new director. And they came up with me. I'd been a history professor at UC Davis for about 20 years, and I'd worked some with Paul, and I was doing disability history, and they invited me to apply, and I did. And since then, I got there in the fall of 2012, and since then we've had a couple of major projects that have been really exciting. Some of you, some of your listeners may be aware of our Patient No More exhibit, which was called Patient No More: People with Disabilities Securing Civil Rights. It's up at the Ed Roberts campus. It will be up until 6 o'clock today, so listeners, you can rush out right now. Well, listen to the end of the show, but rush out right now and go see the exhibit. We will then be hoping to get it out in 2017 to national venues and bring it back to the Bay Area as well, because that will be the 40th anniversary. Basically, the exhibit depicted the 504 occupation of San Francisco's federal building in 1977, and it's kind of the precursor to the Americans with Disabilities Act. And I can go into a little bit of story about that if you want. But essentially, people with disabilities decided that they were not being listened to about the 1973 Rehabilitation Act. It had been signed into law, but nobody was doing anything about making it actually happen. And essentially the Section 504 law said that anybody with a disability couldn't be discriminated by, discriminated against by any federal agency receiving any federal money. So anybody with a disability could not be discriminated against. And the law was on the books, but nobody was following it. And there was no way to punish people who weren't. And they occupied the federal building in San Francisco mm-hmm. for 26 days. It's an amazing story.
They had a lot of allies, right? I mean, like the Black Panther.
Exactly. The Black Panther Party fed them. There mm-hmm. were occupations in 10 U.S. cities, but San Francisco was the only one that survived. Everybody else was starved out or forced out within a day or so. And in San Francisco, thanks to the support from Black Panthers, Glide Memorial Church, Delancey Street Foundation, Gay Men's Butterfly Brigade. It was an amazing group of people or organizations that came together to support this disability rights action. And so it's an amazing story, and we won. The implementation was signed into effect, and it became the precursor for the Americans with Disabilities Act 13 years later. And it's an amazing story.
So that history ends today at Ed Roberts campus in Berkeley.
At 6 p.m. Mm-hmm. However, we do have a website. There's a virtual exhibit. You can go if you missed it or can't get there by 6 o'clock or you want to go back. The website is patientnomore.org, and you can visit all, you can watch all the videos. There's amazing video interviews with people that were there. There's everything's audio described. There's lots of text and photos and everything. So patientnomore.org, and it will be up for as long as we're around, so you can always visit, and we'll be adding to the site constantly.
And another function is the film festival.
Yes, we do Superfest International Disability Film Festival. We're in partnership with the San Francisco Lighthouse for the Blind, which is kind of, some people find rather amusing. Blind people in films are not often uttered in the same breath, except to maybe portray blind people in a weird way in a film. But actually, these are there's judges that are blind and with all sorts of disabilities, but we don't feel that the cinema experience should be limited to just thinking about vision. And so we have audio description for all our films. We show everything audio described. The next Film Festival will be in October 2016. The website is about to open for new submissions to Superfest. So if you know anybody that would be wanting to do films and submit them, we have a pretty rigorous judging process, but all the judges identify as people with disabilities, unlike some other disability film festivals that are out in the world. And we're really excited. We think the audio description actually adds something really exciting to the mix. And so check out the website. It's superfest.org, I think. I can provide that in the with the show, if there's notes with the show.
Okay, but nonetheless, people could always contact the
Longmore Institute. Yeah, we have a link on our webpage that will go right there. And the link for the Longmore Institute is Longmore Institute, all one word, Longmore Institute.edu. Longmore Institute.sfsu, so San Francisco State University.edu.
And are courses taught through the Institute?
We do not teach courses because of the kind of organization that we are at the university. We don't teach courses, but we get people excited about taking courses, and we try to become a clearinghouse for courses that are being offered in specific departments. And we're actually in the process of bringing together a disability studies minor, basically talking about disability in history, anthropology, English, psychology, special ed, all sorts of different courses in different departments. We bring them together so that people that are interested in the area of disability in their major or their professional school can come and get a minor in disability studies, and then they have a lot of confidence that they can go out into the world and talk about disability from a really broad and interesting perspective.
Now, that's at San Francisco State. It doesn't have one right now. It doesn't have a degree or a department.
No.
Okay, but it might have some courses around disability.
Yeah, there's a few. We're trying to, the other piece of it is trying to get faculty members to get excited. Professors, you know, are new to this world and new to the field. And disability studies is kind of where women's history was 30 or 40 years ago, or women's studies was 30 or 40 years ago. You've got a group of people that are pushing it and are excited and really energized by it, and a larger group of people that are, what's that? I'm not sure what that is. Why is that important? That seems kind of irrelevant. And so we're seeing the success of something like women's studies or any of the minority studies, like African-American studies or Latino-Latina studies, all these different things. We're trying to push disability into that and find overlaps and engaged conversations between the two, you know, between the various groups, all of them.
Well, since we as people with disabilities are, 20% of the population, we're just all over the place. There's all kinds of things that are interesting us about. We're creative. I mean, I don't know why at this point, no college, why there are colleges that do not have a disability studies department in 2016.
No, it's an absolutely valid question. And you know, I think it's an interesting one. I think colleges in general, universities in general, are pretty conservative institutions. And I don't mean conservative like in terms of politics, but they don't like taking risks. And the more famous and more important the university is, with the exception of certain public universities, but if it's a private university, they're very, very, you know, kind of careful. They're a little nervous about something that's too new. So they want to see it proven in the public universities first or in lesser universities, and then they jump on.
How's San Francisco State? How's the administration or the board there that makes these kind of decisions?
I think, you know, San Francisco State has long had a social justice mission, and so they're, you know, very much behind disability studies. I think they're very excited by it. They see it as a great opportunity to advance a broader mission at the university. And certainly, you know, Paul Longmore educated a ton of people, inspired in all the good senses of that word. He got a lot of people very excited about disability studies. He won them over, whether they were disabled or not. He was a great force there, and we are, you know, benefiting from a lot of that legacy. A lot of people were very, very influenced by him.
Well, San Francisco State, as I remember, had a really nice legacy of like when the students and supporters organized for black studies and Chicano studies and ethnic studies. So that legacy there is hopefully now it carries over to disability studies. But you know, realistically though, have enough of us been educated? I mean, are there enough of us to be the professors and the educators and the administrators of disability studies in the universities? Are we there yet?
That's a great question. I think we're getting there. I think we're getting closer. I don't think we're there yet. I think we need a lot more representation of a lot more people with disabilities and a lot more different disabilities. There's a lot of people that's, you know, the people that haven't had the opportunities to be educated, people who aren't the privileged disability sort of studies people. I think disability studies is a field that's, you know, like any other field, it's growing in different directions. There's some groups that are more represented than others. There's a lot more room for growth and engagement. We need a lot more people of color in disability studies, for example. It's been primarily white. That's starting to change a little bit, but still, you know, I think that a lot more work could be done there. The certain disabilities like blind people, people with mobility impairments, and the sort of physical, visible disabilities are more represented. But other groups like autistics, people with mental and psychiatric disabilities, all of that stuff, invisible disabilities, chemical sensitivities, all of those are starting to bubble up and offer really interesting insights that we can all learn from. So it's an evolving field. And the bigger it gets, I think the better it is for, you know, raising really interesting and important questions.
We're speaking with Catherine Kudlick. She is the director, executive director of the Paul Longmore Institute based in San Francisco State University. So you've spent, your career has been in the academic field, it seems, in the university. And you received a Doctor of Philosophy in History, Doctor of Philosophy in History degree from the University of California back in 1988. Your dissertation was served as a basis for your first book, which was called, eventually it was a book, I think it was Cholera and Post-Revolutionary Paris, A Cultural History. Can you tell us how this process of writing this book, how instrumental it was in the development of your of yourself as a disability historian?
Yeah, sure. I think ultimately my book about the history of cholera and history of medicine sprung from my own personhood as being somebody with a disability and not really wanting to admit it. So I grew up with a vision impairment my whole life and was taught basically that you deny everything, you don't talk about it, and you kind of soldier on and pretend that nothing's wrong with you. And yet I was working out a lot of the ideas that I wasn't able to talk about in my public life, in my writing. So I was trying to figure out what role does medicine have in shaping who we are in our bodies? What role does medicine play in shaping social attitudes towards people that are sick and uncomfortable and all of those things? So I think what happened with my own case is I was working through a lot of those ideas, not realizing they were about disability. And then what happened is in my first job, I encountered discrimination on the job because of my vision impairment. And just briefly, they asked me as I was interviewing to keep the job. They said, well, we'd like you to teach a large lecture to people. And something about that, this was 1989, right before the ADA. I didn't know anything about disability, didn't want to know anything, whatever. But something tipped me off in my little heart. And I thought, you know, something's wrong with this story.
Is this at UC Berkeley?
It was not at UC Berkeley. Okay. It was a one-year job that I held. And I'm not trying to protect them. I'm just trying to figure out the best way to use this story at some other future point. But essentially, they said, we want you to teach a large lecture class. And I said, are you asking other people to do that, other candidates? And they said, no, we're just concerned that you won't be able to teach a large lecture class. You won't be able to handle it. And I was mad. I was really angry. I just said, you know, I don't know. It came from my gut. It came deep inside. And I just said, no, not doing it. I won't do it. And of course, surprise, surprise, I didn't get the job. And I did a lot of soul searching after that. And as I was, you know, trying to figure out. And the other thing is I was offered several other jobs that year, just so you know. But I was kind of trying to figure out, well, what do I do next? And I saw an job that listed people. They wanted people to talk about minority histories. And something inside, I just thought, wow, you know, in a weird way, I encountered something like being a minority. I encountered prejudice. I encountered stigma. People thought something about me that wasn't me. And I thought, maybe disability's that way. And, you know, it just was completely new to me. And I started reading, and I started reading about blind people and started reading about disability. And you know, there wasn't much history at that point in the early 90s. And I got very excited and got very galvanized, got just really, you know, fired up and thought, this is intellectually exciting. And it's got the capacity to transform society. And that's what really excites me as an academic. I want society to be different. That's why I'm standing up there teaching. It's not that I want people to learn a bunch of stuff. I want people to have tools to change things and to, you know, get the fire in their belly so that they can go forth. And disability was a wonderful opportunity for me to blend my scholarship and my who I was inside.
And this was at UC Davis.
Yes, that's where I did that. And I was basically a historian at UC Davis for 20 years, you know.
In the history department,
mm-hmm. Yeah. Writing my scholarly articles about blind people and disability history and history of medicine. And one book that I did publish that I'm very proud of, I found at the same time as another scholar in France, I found this really amazing manuscript. It was handwritten, and it was by a blind woman in the 1820s in France. And in this manuscript, she said, I'm becoming a burden to my family. I'm going to go to Paris and make my way as a writer. And she was amazing. This scholar and I, we figured out her life. We put it together. We translated the manuscript. And this woman was incredible. She published 10 or 12 novels by the time she was 29. She died in a fire, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. But she did everything she said. And it's an amazing document. She talks about dresses and stars and who should get married, who shouldn't, and should blind girls marry, and if should blind girls marry sighted guys, and if should they marry blind guys. And it's completely modern as a story. And so it was very exciting for me.
Getting back to disability studies departments, are there any departments of this kind that are prominent, that are good models in this country?
Yeah, there's several that are in place and several that are coming. UC Berkeley has a disability studies minor, which is very exciting. University of Illinois at Chicago has a really exciting disability studies program. I know UCLA is talking about it, and I'm not sure where they are. I haven't followed that just recently, so I apologize, UCLA. University of Toledo in Ohio has a disability studies program. There's a number of them. They're scattered, you know, around. There's a lot of options for people.
I think it Kim Nielsen teaches.
That's right.
Yeah, at Toledo. We had her on the program.
Yes. Yeah. No, she's a great, she's mm-hmm. a good friend of mine and a terrific historian. So that's mm-hmm. great.
How about in the high schools or the community colleges? Are there at least disability related courses there, if not departments?
No, there aren't many. And there's part of it's there hasn't been much material. And that's where the history and other academics are starting, historians and other academics are starting to put the material out. Something back in 2011 called the Fair Education Act mandated teaching GLBTQ, et cetera, history and disability history. It was a really interesting alliance to try to get people in California to learn this history. And the GLBT group has been pretty active and good in getting those courses into the classes. But the disability historians, we have a lot more work to do to get those courses into the schools. Our exhibit, Patient No More, we did a lot of outreach with schools and have a traveling version of the exhibit that's gone to different parts of the Bay Area, and we're looking to go beyond. So if you know anybody in your community or your group that would like to talk to us about our exhibit, Patient No More, we have a traveling version with that tells the 504 story in a really interesting way with photographs and stuff. We can bring it into schools, and we had a wonderful experience with Notre Dame High School in San Jose, where over 600 students saw it, and the teachers pegged their classes to it, and all sorts of people did projects, and it was super. It was a super way to do it, and what we'd like to do as the Longmore Institute is get that message and those ideas and the exhibit out into the world.
Catherine Kudlick, we're winding down on this entertaining, enjoyable, and enlightening discussion about the Paul Longmore Institute. We're speaking with Catherine Kudlick, who is the director at the Paul Longmore Institute based at San Francisco State University. I want to ask you another question, though, about disability studies. Do you think a component of a disability studies department where they exist should also allow for students to be active in the community, or should studies be just classroom oriented and have little connection with what's going on?
Oh, my goodness. I can't even imagine a disability studies program that wouldn't be integrated seamlessly with community study and community engagement. I just can't even... that's the great thing about disability studies is it has this opportunity for communication between community members and the university and academics. If you peel off academics and keep it separate, it's sterile, it's empty, there's no passion, it's ideas, but okay, fine. But really where the driving force, as we learned from our exhibit, Patient No More and other programs that we're starting to think about, that's where the excitement comes is you get the people in the community, people that lived this stuff, people whose stories need to be told. We need that. We need those stories out there, and we need all of this. So you can't peel off academics. That would be absolute tragedy.
Catherine, could you give again the contact information for the Paul Longmore Institute?
Yeah, the Longmore Institute. So it's Longmore Institute, all one word, Longmore Institute. .sfsu, San Francisco State University, .edu. That's the website. You can have everything there. And the email address is pklinst, like Paul K. Longmore Institute, @sfsu.edu. And, I think that should... do it.
Okay, and so back to the Film Fest, the Super Fest. It's yearly, and when's the next one?
The next one will be in October. I think it's the third weekend of October. We have two locations. One will be in the East Bay, Berkeley, and the other one will be in San Francisco. And at the, we're formalizing everything, but the website is going to be up very shortly, and I'd like to invite everybody to come and, again, get your friends and whoever that's filmmakers to submit. You can find it on our website. And also if the San Francisco Lighthouse also has a link there as well. But it's Superfest Film Festival. So if you look it up that way, you'll find it.
We've been speaking here on Pushing Limits with Director Catherine Kudlick at the Paul Longmore Institute in San Francisco, San Francisco State. And just a quick announcement about people needing assistance with housing problems, and many people with disabilities do need assistance with housing problems. Centro Legal de la Raza in Oakland is now hosting 3 tenants legal clinics a week on issues such as rent adjustment ordinance, just cause. And these workshops are being held on Mondays, Tuesdays, and Wednesdays from 2 to 4 at the Housing Assistance Center at 250 Franco Gawa Plaza, 6th floor. And that's a lot of information, but if you call up Centro, it's 510-437-1554. And that's Centro, Centro, Legal, like legal, Legal. Pushing Limits. We're heard on the first, third, and fifth Friday of each month at this 2:30 time slot. You can contact us at 510-848-6767, extension 636. And thanks a whole lot to engineer Erica Bridgman. And this is all for now. Eddie Ituarte here at Pushing Limits. Thanks. 'Cause I've got my strength.
Many of us are realizing that a new criminal force is growing stronger and stronger in Latin America. Part terrorists, part corporations, part police. They're doing guerrilla attacks, strong-arming governments, and taking over much of the world's trade in narcotics, guns, and even human beings. As this affects so many of us, especially Latinos,